Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to participate in this symposium. And let me just share my screen. And my name is Patricia Garces. I am an anatomy lecturer at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. And today I'm going to talk to you a project that we are pursuing in the lab, which is to understand the impact of Zika virus in the brain development beyond microcephaly. So in the lab, we are very interested in the early aspects of the cortical development to investigate this early aspect of the cortical development. And if we look at the most anterior part of our brain and slice it coronally, as we can see here, and look at the cells in the microscope, we can see the proliferative zone, and which is very simplified here in this scheme, but where the progenitors are generating the neurons in this first moment of the development. And those neurons, after they are born, they have to perform neuronal migration in order to achieve the layers and form the layers of the neocortex. So then after they differentiate, and finally they find their connections, their targets. So we are very interested in these early aspects of cortical development, because if there are any perturbations or disturbing these early aspects, this will generate cortical malformations. And the cortical malformations are generally grouped in three general groups, which can be related to abnormal survival or proliferation of the progenitors, which will impact the ratio of neurons and glia. And this can generate, for instance, microcephaly, which is a severe reduction of the brain, here depicted on the right. The other group, big group of malformations, are related to abnormal neuronal migration. And this could generate, for instance, types of lysencephaly. And you can see here on the right, you have double cortin, this double cortex being created, which you have arrested cells which could not reach the correct cortical plate and forming this double cortex. And the third group of malformations are caused by aberrant connectivity. And here on the right is just a magnetic resonance image of the absence of the corpus callosum, which is the biggest commissure in the telencephalon. And as you can see here, the tracts, they go parallel, they don't actually cross the midline. So obviously this is an oversimplification of all the cortical development malformations, but this is sometimes these malformations happen independently, but in the patient, it can also happen together, like a syndrome. And this is what happened in 2015, where there was a sudden rise of microcephaly in Brazil. And there was a detection of this sudden rise of this small brain, so this severe reduction of the brain in the northeast of Brazil. And very fast, this was associated to the emergence of this new virus. We were having this new epidemics, which was the Zika virus. And at the time, it was a very unknown virus for us, but it is from the same family of a very known virus, the dengue virus or yellow fever. So it's a flavivirus that encodes 10 proteins, viral proteins. And this virus is actually transmitted sexually and via the vector, the mosquitoes, Aedes aegypti, which are normally here in this tropical area. And we now know that if this mosquito infects a pregnant woman in all the three trimesters, in fact, this could generate what we now call the congenital Zika syndrome. So it could generate a constellation of malformations. And this is because the virus is able to cross the placenta and infect the developing brain. So what we also tested in 2016, very closely to, you know, what happened in 2015, we knew that there was a explosion of microcephaly. We wanted to test if Zika virus could actually impact brain development. And for that, we used human neurostem cells. And we saw that this virus was able to infect the neurostem cells and cause cell death. Also in 3D models like neurospheres, very simple models, or brain organoids, we could see that Zika virus could impact the growth of these 3D structures. So we could link the Zika virus with microcephaly. But we also know that Zika virus can enter in the cell, in the host cell, via different receptors. One of those receptors are the tyrosine kinase receptor, AXL. And this receptor is actually not only in the proliferative areas, but also in different types of cells, such as microglia, and later in the development, the astrocytes will be also generated, and astrocytes will also have these receptors. And we also know that the blood vessels express those receptors. So it is actually not only an impact in the proliferative zone, but in different types, in the neuroprogenitors, but also in different types of cells. And obviously this triggers not only cell death, but also triggers a innate immune response that could also impact the neurons indirectly via the inflammation. And we also know now that the microcephaly is in fact the tip of this iceberg. And then actually there are many other malformations that are related to the syndrome, such as calcifications, the enlargement of the ventricles, the lateral ventricles called ventricular megaly. We have also, these patients have lissencephaly and corpus callosum dysgenesis. And I will talk today a little bit more what we have been learning about how Zika virus can cause corpus callosum dysgenesis. So the corpus callosum, as I said before, is a structure, is a commissure made from the axons of the callosal cells, and that cross the two hemispheres. So there's a communication of the two hemispheres, allow this communication. And for the early formation of the corpus callosum, we can use animal models such as mice to understand how the corpus callosum is developed. And as you can see here in this scheme, this, if you focus on the red cell, we can see that this cell, which is a callosal cell, had to be born here in the proliferative zone around E15 in the mouse, and then from E13 to E15, and then migrate and establish itself in the cortical plate, in the layer 2 and 3, mostly, and also 5 and 6. And then this axon had to grow, so, and then be directed to the midline through a combination of guidance molecules. And those guidance molecules here in the midline, they are actually generated by these populations, the midline populations. And you have here many glial populations that were discovered by Linda Richard, most of them, and here in the mouse and also in the humans. And these populations are very important for the guidance of this axon to cross the midline. And then finally, the axon has to find the target in the contralateral side and harborize. And we are actually interested in understanding how Zika virus disrupt corpus callosum development. That's what I'm going to talk here today. And we are going to look at these different aspects of the callosal development, not only how these cells are generated, but also how they migrate and differentiate and extend the axons and so forth and so on. So for that, we use two different models. So we use a in vivo model, a direct infection model, and also an in vitro model. So the in vivo, I have to say that the wild type mice, they are not very susceptible to Zika virus infection. In fact, they cannot transmit vertically the virus to their offspring very, very in a very successful way. And for that, we have to either use immunocompromised mouse, or we can also inject directly the virus in the lateral ventricles, similar to what we normally do for, you know, in utero electroporations. So here we're just using the same setup and injecting, without obviously electroporate, but in fact, injecting the virus in the intracerebral ventricular injection. And we can also use postnatal mice in P0, for instance, to mimic the third trimester of the humans, and injecting directly in the lateral ventricles and looking at this postnatal development. And we can do this also, we can use in vitro studies, we can do cultures of cortical progenitors, infectocells, cells, which is the main target of Zika in the development. And then after differentiate those cells and have a look at the neurons and how they differentiate. So the first thing we did is to, with Raissa, who is now a postdoc in the lab, was to confirm that we had a congenital Zika syndrome model. So she injected directly in the lateral ventricles the Zika virus and in E15 and harvested in P4. And as you can see, you have a smaller brains and the weight of the brain is reduced. And also she looked at the viral protein NS1, the non-structural protein 1 of the Zika virus. And she could see there are the virus could replicate, and she could also colocalize the virus in the cortical plate. And she could also detect via PCR the presence of the virus. And in order to know if the Zika virus was actually impacting the callosal cells at this point, she counted the total amount of cells of the cerebral cortex, and she saw a reduction of the cells. And specifically, there is a severe reduction of the SATP2 cells, which are the callosal, it's a callosal marker of, it's a marker for callosal cells. And she also cut the brains sagittally, and we could see via histological markers that you can have here with crizal violet, you can see the lack of labeling in the white matter, and you can see the corpus callosum here, and she could measure the area of the infected brains, and she saw a reduction of the corpus callosum, similar to what happens in the patients. So we can say that we can model congenital Zika syndrome with the aspects of the corpus callosum development defects that we wanted to study. So then in order to know if these brains had actually simply a reduction of neurogenesis or a reduction or an increased amount of caspase 3 or for cell death, she looked at the brains, she infected the cells, these brains in E13, and she harvested in E18, and she could see that until E18, there was no caspase 3, so we didn't detect any cell death apoptosis in the brain at this point due to the virus. But with longer exposures of the virus, she could detect a massive amount of cell deaths. And this was also seen in later infections like E15 and P4. So the cell death does not occur before 7 days of exposure of the virus. And so these early aspects of the brain development was actually, they might be impaired, but not by cell death. So then she looked first at the composition of the ventricular zone, and she looked at the apical progenitors, labeling them with a mitosis marker, PH3, and she could see there was a severe reduction of the PH3 labeling in the apical progenitors. When she looked at the TBR2, which are the intermediate progenitors, and these progenitors are the most important for generation of the upper layers. So the population of TBR2 in the controls are there, but are reduced in the infected brains, as you can see here. And this could hint that the reduction of callosal cells could be related to the lack or the reduction of the TBR2 progenitors. So she went to confirm if the SADP2 cells were actually reduced. And for that, she infected the brains in E15, looked at E18, and counted the numbers of SADP2 cells. And so there was a reduction of this population, but not due to cell death, but most possibly due to a proliferation defect or lack of this pool of progenitors. And one thing that she actually didn't notice was any abnormality at this point of the layer information. So when she divided the brain in beans, she could see that actually the cells, the infected cells, were slightly accumulated here in the ventricle, lower layers, but not really significantly, statistically significantly, to say there is a defect at this point. So the position of the neurons were at this point correct. But in order to know if Zika could actually impair the formation of the corpus callosum, so what she did was to insert this lipophilic dye, the dye, and this dye runs into the membranes and in this way in the anterogradually position. So she positioned these dyes in the cortical plate, and then she could follow the axons labeled by this dye. And as you can see, you have axons that cross the midline. And in the Zika virus, you can already see there is a reduction of this path, of the callosal path. When she looked closely with L1CAN, you can see here better. This L1CAN is a marker of these callosal cells, the callosal axon, sorry. And you can see here that in the midline, there is a reduction of the corpus callosum in E18 already. And with the dye, she could also observe that the tracts, the callosal tracts, were defasciculated. They had other abnormalities. Not only they were reduced, but also defasciculated, and also some aberrant. She could observe some aberrant tracts. Then that would suggest that we could have a pathfinding defect and also a growth defect. And this defect of defasciculation was maintained if she infects the brains in P0 and wait for 7 days. She could also see this defasciculation in the midline. Now, in order to know if this defect of the Zika infection was directly impacting the growth of the axons, what Haissa did together with Jefferson, they established these cell cultures that they infected the progenitors, differentiated the cells, and then these neurons, they were often not infected, but they were exposed to this environment that was infected, similar to what happened in vivo. So they labeled these neurons after 4 days in vitro, so shortly after, with SADP2, so they are callosal cells, and you can see, and they also could measure the growth of the axon, the longest neurite. And you can see there is a reduction of these axons in vitro in the infected cultures. And also, not only the axons were affected, but also the dendrites were affected. And then if you do a Shaw analysis, they could observe that there were less branchings in these neurons. In vivo, this was corroborated at least looking at the Golgi staining, infecting the brains in P0, looking at P11. And you can see there is a you can see there is a reduction of the brain, but also when Haisa looked at the morphology of those neurons and she looked at pyramidal neurons, and she could find actually less branches and actually the extension of the less apical dendrites, less basal dendrites, and also less branchings. So very similar to what we saw in the in vitro. So I'm wrapping up because I'm reaching the 20 minutes here. And other aspect that could be impacting the pathfinding of these axons are the midline glia populations. So what she did was to label with GFAP these midline glial populations, and she measured the intensity of the signal in the infected brains. And she could see that even the inducing grisium midline glia was reduced, and also at least the intensity of the signal, and also the midline zipper glia was also reduced. And that means that most possibly the molecules that this glia produced, they could also be reduced. So she's also checking that. With RNA-seq, very briefly, we found that the brains that were infected had a massive deregulation in axon-related genes, mostly downregulation of those genes, and sometimes upregulation of axonal degeneration genes. And most of the processes that were impacted here in this circle plot analysis, we could see there were lots of genes related to axonogenesis, also related to the growth cone, and some molecules that are very crucial for the callosal path findings, such as semaphorin 3C, they were also downregulated. So she's pursuing that. What we could also see in this model was a massive upregulation of microglia that, as I said, could be impacting also the growth of these axons. We'll skip this because I'm running out of time, just to say that this phenotype, it maintains in postnatal stages. And in postnatal stages, we don't have any defect in the neurogenesis of the SAPI2 cells, but we still have a defect in the corpus callosum area. So there is a reduction of this area, and we are investigating what would be the causes for this reduction. So just to acknowledge my collaborators, first of all, Roberto Lente, who hosts our group in the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, the group who is working currently in this project, the funding agencies, and here are the social media contact that you can find me. Thank you.